What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. The next sorting algorithm we are going to tackle today is insertion sort. This algorithm is actually quite an interesting one, because while playing a card game, most people use a similar method to sort the cards they are holding in their hands. Let's take this set of 6 cards as an example. The first thing any sane human will notice is this 2 of hearts right there. And I personally wouldn't be able to start playing until I move this card to the front of my hand, as it is the smallest card I am holding right now. After we move the 2 of hearts, the second out-of-place card we can notice is the 8 of hearts. This card should go right between the 7 and the 9. Now we can start playing. What we did here was actually use the insertion sort algorithm to sort this set of cards. This algorithm works better on smaller chunks of data than on larger ones. In practice, this algorithm is more efficient and easier to write in code than the 2 algorithms we previously discussed, the bubble sort and the selection sort. Now let's take this array of integers as an example and try to sort it using the insertion sort algorithm. Also, let's try to do that while relating it to what we did a few seconds ago with the playing cards. Because you see, the 2 of hearts didn't catch our eye directly just because it was out of place, but also because the cards that came before it were already kind of sorted. In this array, you can see that the first 2 elements are already sorted. Therefore, if we wanted to take the same approach we took while sorting the cards, the 3rd item is the first one we should start with. What we need to do now is take this element, the 3rd one, and try to fit it among the other sorted 2. So we just ignore all other items in the array for now. All the items that come after this element are not important. We are focused on this element, on this card. We want to fix it, fix its place, in order to be able to focus on something else. Now, this integer is a 7, and its place is between the 3 that we have and the 22. We now have 3 elements in our array that are sorted, and 4 still remaining. You may also notice one similarity between this and the selection sort algorithm, as these 3 items can now be considered as a sorted subarray, and the remaining elements as the unsorted subarray. And with every iteration, what we are doing is taking one item from the unsorted subarray and try to find its corresponding place in the sorted one. The next item we have, or the 4th item, is -1. As you can see, this integer is smaller than all the ones present in the sorted subarray. So, this element should be the first, or should move to the front of the array, and that is exactly where we are going to place it. The same methodology is applied on the remaining 3 elements until all of them are sorted. Now, before starting to implement this algorithm, there is one last thing I want to mention, and it is how the element that we are sorting, the one we are focusing on, is actually inserted inside the sorted subarray. Let's go back a bit to when we were inserting or moving the -1. You see, we already established that this -1 should be placed at index 0, or at the front or start of our array. To move it there, we can't just swap it with integer 3. Because then, the order of the numbers would be -1, 7, 22, 3. And that is the wrong ordering. So, to insert the -1, what we have to do is make place for it. To do that, it should be swapped with the elements preceding it, one by one. So, we have to first swap it with 22, then swap it with 7, then with 3. And only after that the ordering will become -1, 3, 7, and 22, as we wanted it. Now, with this in mind, let's go ahead and implement the insertion sort algorithm. The first thing we want to do, as we did for our previous sorting algorithms, is create our insertion sort class. Now, this class can be used to sort strings as well as numbers or any other custom objects we create. So I went ahead and added a generic parameter that extends the comparable interface. This interface will grant access to the compareTo method, providing us with a way to compare all types of objects we are dealing with. Now, the array we want to sort is assigned to a variable inside our constructor, which takes it as a parameter. This way, the array will be accessible from any method we create inside this class, including our sort method, of course. Okay, to sort our array, the first thing we did, if you recall, was look at the first out-of-place integer. In code, we have to do exactly the same thing. And this is done by iterating over every item and checking if it's out of place. This iteration, though, starts from the second element or the element at index 1. Why? Well, because the first item can't be compared to any other item. Remember, when we compare an item, we compare it to the ones in front of it. And the first element is the first one. It has no items preceding it to compare it to. Inside this loop or iteration, as I mentioned, we have to compare the element we are sitting at to ones before it. Now, if the item we are focusing on is smaller than the one preceding it, we swap these elements. The swapping is done, as shown inside the if statement, by creating a temporary variable. We already discussed the swapping in our selection and bubble sort videos, so I'm not going to spend too much time on it here. Now, you see in this example, we still have a problem, because this if statement only compares our current item to the one preceding it. But what we want is to compare this element to all the items that precede it, one by one, right? So if we went back to the minus 1 example and ran this code on it, all it will be doing is swapping the minus 1 with the 22. But what we want is to swap it also with the 7 and the 3 all the way till we reach index 0. So what we actually require from our code is to run this if statement we just wrote from the item we are currently standing at, or index I in our example, all the way backwards till we reach index 0. In code, this is done by wrapping this if statement with a for loop going backwards from our current item index till 0. However, there is still a minor problem with this implementation. What if the minus 1 we had was not a minus 1, but a 10? Let's imagine it together. You see, with what we just wrote in our code, we will correctly place the 10 between the 7 and the 22. But this loop will not stop. We won't exit this loop until we reach index 0. So this current code will iterate over 7 and minus 1. But you and I know that these iterations are useless because no swapping will be performed. So what we need is actually something like this. We need to break out of the inner for loop when this condition is no longer met. This will improve the performance of our algorithm. Now the combination of the if condition and the else block of our if statement can be replaced with something way more elegant, in my opinion at least. We can move the condition we had inside the if statement and add it to the for loop condition along with the j greater than 0 condition already present. Between these two conditions, we have to use the AND operator. This loop ensures that only as long as the elements preceding our current element are smaller than it, the swapping code will be executed. And if this is not the case, the inner loop will end, and the outer for loop will continue its iteration. Another way to extract this logic, and maybe the cleaner way, is to use a while loop. This while loop will hold the same aggregated condition we had in our for loop, and its iterator will be initialized before the loop and incremented at the end of it. The starting value and increment of this iterator will be similar to what we had in the inner for loop. Now let's go ahead and test our algorithm on a couple of arrays. For this, I created a main method and two arrays, one holding integers as you can see, and another holding strings. I also went ahead and printed out the initial state of these arrays, how these numbers and strings are placed inside the arrays before we perform any kind of sorting. After we call the sort method we just implemented and print the resulting arrays to the console, you can see that both arrays are now sorted. The array storing integers is sorted in ascending order, starting from the smallest integer, and the array storing strings is sorted alphabetically. And if we wanted to sort in descending order, all we have to do is replace the smaller than operator in our while loop with a greater than operator. Now, in the last section of this video, I want to provide you with an alternate way to code the insertion sort algorithm. It is the same code we just wrote, and it will generate the same output, but written using a combination of streams and recursion. So, let's start by creating a new method and name it sort. It will be an overloaded version of the one that will be called, because it takes an integer as a parameter. Inside this method, we are going to put the same condition we had inside the while loop, but as an if statement. Everything we are doing inside this while loop will remain intact, except for decrementing the value, of course. This one will be replaced with a recursive call to the same method that takes as parameter the input index minus 1. So with this recursive call, we are trying to move to the preceding item in the list. In the initial sort method, we are going to call this recursive method for each index we have, starting from index 1, just as our outer for loop did. However, to do it in a more concise way, we are going to use Java streams. So for an int stream ranging from 1 to whatever the length of the array is, we are going to call this recursive method. And there you have it, the insertion sort version 2, ready to go. Finally, if you are not really a fan of recursion, there is a third way to write this logic using only Java streams. This is done using the iterate method. This method is what will replace our previous inner for loop or while loop if you choose to go with that. The rest of the code stays basically the same. What we did was only eliminating the recursive call by replacing it with an iteration. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.